The following program is brought to you by the Buns the Cat Foundation. At the Foundation for Buns the Cat, we think birds are jerks. It's also brought to you by Absolute Boredom. Howdy there, hope you're doing great. This week on the Arcade Workshop Quarantine Chronicles, we're going to restore the control panel on our Centipede Cabaret. It's gonna look great, you're gonna love it. And we're gonna start working on some of the major projects. Namely, we're gonna tackle our Simpsons upright. So we'll have all that exciting stuff to do on the show today. Let's get started. All right, so as we discussed in one of the first videos, we want to replace this rather beat up and destroyed overlay for my Centipede Cabaret game. And this, as far as I know, is the original overlay for this, and it's far, far due for a new refresh. So we're gonna strip it, bear it down to metal, paint it, and put a new overlay on it, and hopefully make it look brand spanking new again and give this game some much needed love. Now, once you're inside your control panel, if you're lucky, most control panels will simply, all the controls will just unplug with a big quick release, kind of Molex style connector or what have you. Sometimes if it's an older conversion game, they may be plugged in individually and you'll have to go through and label all these things. But the Centipede is a pretty easy thing here. You just have these two bolts that will unscrew and bring the whole thing off, and then you're set to go. If you have any other extra bolts, I always recommend putting them in a Ziploc bag, carefully labeling everything, just because you tend to forget. You think you're not going to forget what goes where, but you will. So the more labeling on these things, the better. So we've already taken it off the machine, and you're going to want a couple things before you do this. First, obviously, you need your control panel. I like using a Ziploc bag for putting all the different parts and pieces in there and then labeling the bag, because even though you may think you're going to remember where things go, you'll probably forget as the project goes on, or if you had to pause for a bit and just label everything, make it real clear. Trust me, you'll be glad you did that. Okay, so obviously we need our new overlay. We've got this really nice silk screened Centipede Cabaret overlay, and I can't, it's been so long since I bought this thing. I don't even remember where I got it from, but I want to say I got it from the people at Phoenix Arcade, and they do a lot of really great work, and they mostly do silkscreen stuff, I think. And they did the great new bezel on glass for my Rally X upstairs. Just A-plus work. So I'm going to need a scraper to get the old overlay off, and I like using a heat gun for the overlays that are sticker-based initially, and then we'll have to sand down to bare metal before we proceed any further. You're also gonna need whatever tools you'll need to get the various controls off. Now, the other thing I want to tell you is that Centipede, obviously, there's not a lot going on control-wise here, but some of the more complicated control schemes, you wanna label what each button is before you take it off the control panel, just to save yourself whole bunch of headache later on when you're trying to figure out if that's button A or C or joystick 2 or whatever. It's all labeled and you won't have any issues. Okay, so let's get started and let's make this thing looking fantastic again. All right, so you've taken all your controllers and wiring and your screws out and you're ready to strip the old control panel. So I like to use a heat gun and a kind of a little metal spatula scraper to get this stuff off here. You have to be careful not to burn yourself or others. I actually burned my wife when I was doing this, unfortunately, but it comes off a lot easier also to have a helper. And then you want to get as much of that glue off as possible because it's just a huge pain in the neck to get it off. Otherwise, you are going to have to do a lot of sanding, a lot of scraping. Here, I also tried a little bit of stripper. The stripper, unfortunately, doesn't seem to work as well on glue. You could try some acetone or some traditional kind of harsher strippers to get some of that stuff off. But sometimes, unfortunately, you just have to kind of grin and bear it. And you have to just keep on sanding and stripping down the best you can with this stuff. And eventually, you will get this stuff off. It just,
It just unfortunately takes a good bit of time. Here you can see the final product, almost there, almost all off at this shot. And we keep on sanding both the bottom and the top there with a detail sander to get some of those harder to reach areas inside. This is a good time too. Once you start sanding, you start seeing some rust spots. You go ahead and get rid of that rust before we repaint. And there, it's looking great. Strip down to bare metal, and then we're going to repaint it just with some high gloss black, both on the bottom and on the top, using some nice social distancing between you and the spray gun to make sure that it is sprayed well. And there we have a nice base to put our new overlay on. Voila. Okay, so for some unknown reason, the audio portion of me speaking, which is the reason why the it looks kind of weird right now, didn't record this video, but in a nutshell, some best practices. Once the paint has dried and you're finished and you're ready to put on your overlay, you really want to make sure that surface is as clean as possible. And even though you've already done a lot of prep work to get to this point with the painting, it's not a bad idea really to get yourself some real fine sandpaper and to do a nice wet sand back and forth with the sand block. You know, you don't want to scrub at this point any sort of major imperfections. It should be done and over with. This is really just final prep work, and you really only need to sand the part that you're putting the overlay on. It's just a best practice on there. And here you can see I'm attempting to show the world how to sand instead of scrubbing aggressively. So hey, don't do that. So there's that. The other thing too is to make sure that the surface is as clean as possible. Now, some people like to use like alcohol or Windex to clean the surface from any imperfections before you put on these things. It's a little piece of fiber or hair or a little unknown piece of whatever could really ruin the overlay, especially over time, and get underneath the surface. So make sure your area you're working on is clean. Don't use paper towels. That's kind of what I'm explaining here, because paper towels tend to flake and leave all sorts of debris, especially if you have a sanded area. Okay, from that point, let's talk about the overlay. We'll go back to the actual video here.
Now, we're pretty lucky because our overlay has been pre-cut as far as where all the holes and buttons go, and it's very accurate, but sometimes it's not. So there's some debate whether or not it's better to have these pre-cut or not. What is a good idea, however, just in case things go awry, is have a nice little X-Acto knife kit. These kits you can buy a real nice one at an art supply store for peanuts. These are imperative for control panels. Just a good idea to have an X-Acto knife kit. Anyway, okay, so we're just about ready to go here and put our overlay on. So, of course, the biggest thing with this is alignment. Because you get one chance at this. This stuff is very sticky, and once it's down, it's down. You want to have your alignment as true as possible. It's kind of like the old adage to measure twice and cut once. It's very true here. Planning goes a long way. So let me show you kind of how I do it. Some people have different ways. Now, as you see, I've kind of lined this up with blue tape on the sides and edges. This is the major part of the overlay here, and it's aligned as best as it's going to be. It's pretty accurate for being a die cut overlay. It seems like it was made pretty well. Blue tape is pretty non-abrasive, so it shouldn't leave any marks on either the front or the back side of our overlay. So I'm going to flip over my overlay, and you see we have this little tab here. Now, some people like to start at the top, which is not necessarily a bad idea, to be honest with you, but how I'm going to do this is this way, because just the shape of this overlay. I'm going to take my X-Acto knife, take one with a decent blade here, and I'm going to very, very carefully cut the back of the adhesive backing off. I'm not going to go all the way through, so this requires a pretty steady hand. Again, you know, this is just kind of the way I've always done it, and it works out pretty well for me.
Okay, so I'm going to do a little vocal overdub here, just to kind of explain what I'm doing a little bit further. I felt like I didn't do a very good job. I like to cut just a small bit of the backing off, either in the center or towards the edge, wherever I feel comfortable, and overlay that first instead of having to deal with the full kind of realm of it. Now, some people like to use what's called a wet technique, where they'll get the surface wet to kind of give it a little more play. The great thing about this overlay was, I don't know if it's just because it was older or the type of material, but I was able to pull it off and on a couple times without too many problems. It gave me some chance to align it. But if you do put some water with a little spray gun, not like buckets of water, while you're doing this onto whatever surface you're using, you can actually kind of move it around a little bit before it goes quite down. But on something small like this, I didn't bother using the wet technique. That works really well with side art, especially side art that's like the full length of the game. And we'll get into that a little bit more when we do some work on our Simpsons game. But you can do this, you can either cut that little bit in the center and take it from there, or you can just start from the very edge if you feel like you're comfortably lining up on the edge and start from there. I've done it that way as well. So lots of different ways to do this. I think that the bottom line is just to make sure everything is as lined as possible and that you're comfortable when you peel it, when you start to actually stick it down, because some of them you don't get a second chance to stick it. Okay, so now that I have that back lip done, what I'm gonna do for precaution, as you can see, it doesn't quite line up perfectly, but that's okay, because all my holes are still aligned. I'm actually gonna tape this edge down with my blue tape for alignment's sake, just in case I get some peel up when I take the sides off. So now here comes a big moment here where no guts, no glory. And if you have the ability to have two people, especially while you do larger overlays, it's very, very helpful for sure. So obviously the repositioning and kind of getting all this down is just kind of time consuming. You just, an extra pair of hands here are very, very helpful. I usually do this with a second person. I was trying to do it just solo because my wife was working at the time, and just to kind of show how to do this the best I could with one person. But if you have two people, it definitely works. You just need to be careful and take your time and try to minimize as many air pockets and changing your alignment. Remember, with any of these things, it's not a race. You just really need to take a breath and be careful, especially after all that hard work you did prepping it.
So we're totally repopulated and ready to go. It's looking great. I even put a new button on there just because the old one was looking pretty tired. Some other best practices with this, when you're reassembling and putting your control panel back together, it's a good opportunity to clean out all the little crevices and things of your controllers if you're still using the original buttons and joysticks and things, and get rid of those years of hand salsa that are caked in there. Also clean out your wiring harness in the back. You know, it's a good chance to just do a little sprucing up. Since you've gone this far, you might as well go all the way. If you have any extruding bolts that go on the front, you want to be careful of two things. One, you don't want to over tighten this stuff, because if you over tighten it, it will crack the new control panel. Maybe not right away, but over time, and it will look pretty terrible, and you'll be sorry you did that. So make them tight, but don't go crazy. The other thing that's a good idea is if you have any of these bolts that are looking pretty shabby, maybe rusty or whatnot, go ahead and sand them and paint the tops of them too, or buff them down to just total metal, depending upon, you know, what originally it was supposed to be, I guess, depending upon your game. So there you go. There's our Centipede control panel. It's looking pretty good. So we're going to go ahead and put it back on the machine right now.
I brought it up to the arcade and reinstalled it into our Centipede cabaret, and voila, there, it looks great. Just super funky fresh. The only kind of downside there are the little Windex smudge you can see from where I cleaned it, is that the trackball's kind of yellow compared to that brand new white button. But man, what a difference a new control panel makes. Unfortunately now, it really draws attention to the kind of beat up Koi Mex that also needed restoration. But hey, we'll save that for another time. So a really great job, really happy, it looks great. It responds great. All the buttons are wired up correctly the first time. And hey, there you go. And we'll have a little bit of a before and after shot here to see. Yeah, it looks great. Okay, well, one minor project finished. Hey, what about that?
Those of you who watched the other episodes of this this show have noticed that we have six major projects now. In the workshop, we have the Arkanoid, we have the Space Harrier, the new arrival, the Red Donkey Kong cabinet, the Stargate / Moon Patrol cabinet, and then we also have our Jungle King cocktail and the Simpsons. Most of these games, I'm actually waiting for parts and pieces, especially artwork from different vendors, that because of the virus situation right now in the United States, I have no idea when I'm gonna get this stuff. So we're just gonna have to wait to see when it shows up, and there's no pressure on any of these vendors because most of these people are good folks and I know they're doing the best they can. But Simpsons is a special case because I ordered the artwork from this old game, both the side art and the marquee and the control panel artwork months and months ago, and have already received it from this old game, who, by the way, they do amazing work over there. A lot of people complain that it takes too long, but you are always willing to wait for quality, friends. You should. I also have new old stock Wico joysticks in the right colors. I bought these from a guy in Cyprus, the country. And so we've already stripped our control panel. So let's take a look at the cabinet and take a look at some of the work I've already done with the control panel, and we're gonna move forward with the Simpsons game. Welcome to my monitor stash portion of the workshop. And this is a 25-inch CRT. This is not the original monitor for the Simpsons, but this is the one that was in mine. I've totally rebuilt it, recapped it, and now it doesn't work. So we do need to address this. I don't think there's any problem with the tube. I think I've screwed something up with the chassis and it just won't ignite because you can hear it try to work, but there's no glow and there's no picture. So that's where we are with that. The board also has a sprite glitch that we're trying to get fixed, and we'll see how that happens. But let's look at the cabinet and the control panel overlay, because that will need the most work and it's what we can deal with pretty much right now. I don't know if you can say I've ever bought anything on a whim at an auction, but I bought the Simpsons kind of on a whim. I've always loved these Konami four-player games, and I think the Simpsons is actually my favorite between this and the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle series. The biggest problem or challenge with this game is the front. Someone at some point just smashed the crap out of this thing, and it's totally smashed and broken throughout. It's supported from behind with some metal brackets. This entire front panel is not fixable. It's gonna have to be removed, come out, and we're gonna make a whole new panel. Also, the bottom edge corners are broken. One of these corners was broken on one side when I first bought the game. The other one broke when we moved to Seattle, unfortunately. There's also, when I stripped all the artwork off the sides, I found there's also a little bit of water damage on the bottom of this game. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use our new biscuit joiner and we're gonna cut part of the cabinet on the sides out after we kind of drill and replace this front piece. And we're gonna also fix the bottom sides so they're perfectly straight, look brand new and flush before we ever even think about putting the artwork on it.
I've actually already done quite a bit of work on this cabinet. Stripping the artwork took quite a bit of time. The original artwork was in really, really bad shape. So we started focusing on the control panel, which also needed a lot of patchwork on the bottom portion that I'm still working on. The actual control panel had these joysticks that didn't belong. I went ahead and disassembled all of that and started cleaning and sanding up all the goo, taking off this, which I think is a reproduction overlay, which just the colors seem very, very bad, not in a faded way. It just seemed like it was poorly printed. So again, with our heat gun and our scraper and see all that glue, ugh, that took forever to get off. But here we are, we're fixing the base part a little bit more, putting some patchwork. And there's the control panel all nicely stripped off, and we went and repainted it. And now I'm just waiting for the artwork to flatten out because it was all curly. It had been sitting in a package, and this was again made from this old game. It looks great. We're gonna give it a couple days to flatten out though first.
other than those minor things, the cabinet overall is actually in pretty good shape. And why restore it? Why not just make a whole new cabinet? Well, because we want to keep it as original as possible, which sounds crazy because we'll be changing a lot of this cabinet with new artwork and things, but I think it's important to try to maintain this as much as possible and keep the bones of it, even though this is a heavily damaged cabinet. So that's just my personal philosophy anyway. Otherwise, we could just make a new one. We could CNC a new one from scratch. Just wouldn't be the same, I don't think. So we're gonna fix this one, we're gonna restore it, and we're gonna get rid of this last little bit of artwork I need to take off there. And we're gonna start using our biscuit joiner probably next week to really get going. So that's pretty much it for this edition episode of the show. By next week, I will probably make a lot of progress with the Simpsons here. And we're also gonna do some control panel work on our Jungle King. And we may even, hopefully, by next week, we may have some artwork arrive or some other things that we've ordered. So we'll just have to wait and see. So thanks for watching. Stay safe. You know, don't be a jerk to everyone. Be nice. Everyone's going through the same thing right now. Just wash your hands. You know, stream a bunch of Buffy the Vampire Slayer or whatever gets you going through it. And take care of each other. See you next time.